Hey guys, it's Jenna Elfman from Fear the Walking Dead. I play Laura. No, I play Naomi. No, I play June. I play June on Fear the Walking Dead. And you're listening to the Fear the Walking Dead Talk Through on Talk Through Media.
Hey, I'm Lindsley Register, and I play Laura on The Walking Dead. You're listening to The Walking Dead Talk Through on Talk Through Media.
Hello, and welcome to episode 79 of Fear the Walking Dead Talk Through. I'm Brian.
And I'm LT.
And unfortunately, we're going to pull this out right now and say that Kyle has unfortunately decided that because he just moved and he's getting settled in and he's got too much going on right now, so he has decided to step down from the podcast for the rest of the season. So he hopes to come back in August and join us for season 11A of The Walking Dead. But until then, it's just LT and me. So
you're stuck with us.
Yeah. And all I have to say about that, of course, is we'll miss you, Kyle, but hopefully you will be back soon. So
do what you got to do, brother.
And we are going to do something that, well, it's been a while since we've done it. In the past, we've done it because there's been a double episode. I know when World Beyond was finishing up, there was a double episode that week. Oh, of course, we were doing it all through season 6A because of World Beyond being on at the same time. But we're going to do two episodes this week because, unfortunately, we were unable to record last week. So, LT, you are now fully vaccinated, but...
Yes, I am.
Yeah, but unfortunately... You had a reaction, it seems.
I did have a reaction.
Yeah.
And just due to circumstances beyond our control, The Walking Dead Talk Through was unable to record.
Yeah, and you know, it's funny. Like if Kyle had been, you know, able, we would have went ahead, but you know, the double whammy. And we got to a point like you were starting to feel better by the end of the weekend. It's like, there's no point. We might as well just cover them both in the same episode. So,
yep. So,
and it worked out in a way because, the two episodes are so different that I think we can do that without, a lot of difficulty this time around. So, we'll be doing a double episode covering Fear the Walking Dead season 6, episode 11, titled The Holding, and then season 6, episode 12, titled In Dreams. But first, we have some feedback for Fear the Walking Dead season 6, episode 10, Handle with Care, or mostly the podcast about it. So let's open with Rick. And Simon.
We can talk about it.
We're done talking. Time to listen.
So we've got one voicemail, and that is from Renee from Atlanta. So this is our only voicemail this week. And I will have stuff to say afterwards.
Brian, hey, LT, I don't know if Kyle's back or not this week, but I... just listen to the podcast from Things Left to Do because y'all had it. It was so late. I think y'all didn't get it in until last Saturday. I work on Saturdays. I work in a hair salon. So I'm extremely busy. Then I went out of town to Myrtle Beach for vacation. So I didn't get to listen to it until today. OMG. I mean, you really touched me because I didn't lose a best friend. My best friends have been my best friends forever, 30 plus years. So I can only imagine what I would do. And I just would like to say this, not saying that you're an addict, But my husband was an addict. My husband has been clean now for 19 years. And my husband, he says the same thing that you say. You have to be honest. You have to be honest with the man in the mirror. In order to get help, you have to be honest. You got to put it all out there on the table. You can't leave nothing, hold nothing back. You know, in order to get help. My husband tried to get help. He was an addict before I met him. When I met him, he was 2 years clean. But I have went to some of the AA meetings with him. He was on crack. Alcohol wasn't his drug of choice. And my husband now, he won't pick up anything. The whole night, we've been together. He's been clean 19 years. So we've been together 21. Well, he's been clean 17 years. We've been together 19 years. He has not picked up any alcohol. He has not picked up anything the whole time he and I have been together, because he said that if he pick up alcohol, if he drink any alcohol, it'll lead him to his drug of choice, which is crack. And I have attended meetings with him, and the fact that people are so open and honest the way that they are is amazing to me. And to see how hard it is, I've never been there, but I know that it got to be really, 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 really hard. And I just want to salute you for being so transparent. I mean, I think you're going to help a lot of people, because COVID probably had a lot of people drinking and doing things they wouldn't do otherwise. I was praying for my husband, you know, the whole time. Please, God, don't allow him to, you know, fall back, you know. But he was never closed in, because my husband has his own truck, 18-wheeler. So, of course, he was out in the forefront because he was considered essential, because he was delivering, you know, the things that we need. But still, I'm going to continue to pray for you. I mean, God got you and you got you. This is going to work itself out. It is going to work itself out. I can hear the determination in your voice, and you're going to make your best friend proud. You know, that's what he will want, is for you to not drink, you know, for you to just continue to carry on his legacy. But I understand how it feels. I don't understand how it feels to lose a best friend, but I know a best friend, man, that's like a part of you. So again, I salute you, brother, and I'm going to continue to pray for you. Y'all got my feedback from.
And it ends there. So first, of course, we have to say, thank you so much, Renee, for that feedback. Of course, that was mostly about the stuff I've been saying the last couple of episodes. And, it's now time for part 3. Because I want to clear up a couple of things from that. And, you know, again, this is going to be another one where it's going to be difficult for, I don't know what I'm going to say. I don't know how much I'm going to say. I don't know how much that I'll say that I'll end up pulling out of the final recording. But I'm just gonna go by feel, and the things I'm about to say about myself are not going to be flattering, but you know, maybe my honesty will help people. Hi, this is Brian, and I'll call this take 15. I don't know if it is or not, but this is not the first version, and it's not the second, third, or fourth version of what I originally said last Tuesday night when LT and I recorded our episode. And I sat on this for days trying to figure out what to do with what had been said. Part of me wanted to release it as is, and part of me said, I can't. And there are multiple reasons why I can't, and I don't want to go into them, because if I did, there wouldn't be any point. I'd have to, I'd just be better off just releasing it. But let's just say that the things that I did were reprehensible. I didn't lose the friend because the person died. My behavior caused this friend to disavow me and never want to have anything to do with me again. And it wasn't, how can I put it? My behavior was erratic. That's what I'll say. You can, I'll just leave it to say that there were some mental health issues that I was experiencing that were aggravated as a part of COVID. That I will say, I'm not going to go get any more specific than that. And I already talked about the problems that I had with drinking during COVID. They weren't the problems either. They aggravated the problems, but they weren't the problems. But what happened caused me not just to lose that friend, but to lose other friends. And, you know, it's caused problems at home and a lot of issues, not just, you know, with other people, but within myself. I have to live with things that I did, and I don't feel very good about who I was as a person in 2020 and even into 2021, because, you know, this went into this year as well. I did keep a version of the what was said, so I may let certain people hear it. I already have let a couple of people hear it. But beyond that, it's just going to be between me and the people that are involved. So anyway, that's about what I have to say. I will regret my actions for the rest of my life. And I will deeply regret. I've lost people, not just one friend, but I've lost multiple friends, people that were very dear to me, as a result of my actions. And, you just don't fully recover from those things. You have to move forward, but you know, it's tough. So that's what I've been going through, and that's all I'm going to say about it. So, again, there is a version, and if you really want to hear it, you can send me a private message, and maybe if you ask nicely enough, maybe I'll let you. But otherwise, it's a private affair. So, okay, thanks. You know, so anyway, that's all I have to say about it.
Okay.
As I said, I probably said a lot more than you're going to hear. But we'll see.
All right.
So I did want to bring up some errata. And that is for Aaron from the internet. I said in the last episode that we had that there haven't been any anything from this show that's been in The Walking Dead. That's wrong. I forgot about one thing, and I immediately remembered what that thing was when Al came across it in the episode, and that was those like charts or whatever, the CRM, the stuff, her, you know,
all the map acetates, all the map overlays,
all of that, and the organization that Isabel, I think is her name, right? That she was part of. I thought what's his name? Dwight called her Nora. I was kind of confused by that, but anyway, I think it's Isabel. Anyway, Isabel is a helicopter pilot for the CRM, and the CRM has actually been in all three of the shows. So that's the thing. So,
okay.
CRM. So that's about the only example I can think of that's been in all three. So, and has been in Fear. So anyway, all right, LT, I'm going to let you read the feedback we got from Aaron from the internet for our last episode.
Okay. Starts off by saying, another good banner selection for the week. It was nice to see Daniel get this episode to himself, basically, after being away for so long. It's okay, Brian. You tried. It's like the show Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., always mentioning the movies, but the movies never threw the show a bone by having even a small nod to it there. all those films, and they couldn't once mention the show or events in it in passing. The show literally gave the universe Inhumans, but sure, let's just ignore that. It was insulting, you know? I understand, like the movies, TWD is the main property, but still, if you're going to push it on another series, the least you could do, since this is supposed to be a universe and not a glaring spinoff, we actually take place before the breakout, so arguably TWD is post-us, is have a mention here or there on the main show. Seriously, how hard would it be for them to find a tape the group made? They don't even have to watch it. Just find it. John Dory died, so maybe someone finds his cabin, but you don't have to interact with the character now, of course. You could legit have a character who strayed from our pack be on the main show for a quick arc like they've doing Sherry here. It's not that hard. I just don't like the one-sided feel of it all, if that makes sense.
Well, we could end up... Sorry, I was just going to say, speaking of that, like, merging of things... We know that there are characters that are going to continue after The Walking Dead into another show, and we know that the place New Mexico has been mentioned. Whether or not they'll end up there, we don't know. But of course, if they end up in New Mexico, Texas is not. You would have to go to Texas to get to to New Mexico, so they could always surprisingly find a few people, and be funny if, like, if Morgan,
you know, Dwight,
yeah, Dwight, yeah,
maybe Carol and Daryl will find a beer balloon.
Oh God, I could just see like, Carol and Daniel or
yeah
or something like that, or Aaron and Strand.
Oh, that would be good.
They don't seem like they'd be the same type, but
yeah,
anyway.
Okay, well, he goes on to say, if someone else was here, you mean like Kyle? Miss you, Kyle.
We do too.
We'll see you soon, hopefully. Smiley face. Totally agree with LT. Daniel is innocent. And there you go. Here's an idea also regarding the gun shed. Lockpick. You know, some thieves survived this long. In quotes, maybe Charlie is her probation officer. Laughing face, laughing face, laughing face. That may be a better one than Ranger Dingus.
Ha. Yeah, well, they were both good.
Yeah. Then, you know, why the fuck has he waited so long to go get it? And several clapping hand emojis. Brian, it's especially stupid because he was going to take Grace to the dam, he said, after finding her. So, yes. Why is all her stuff still at the water tower as many times as you've been out doing who knows what, Borgen? Things like this is why there should be no leader. They're all stupid when the plot needs.
And I wonder about for this past episode, did June get the fetal monitor? Is that where it ended up? I don't know.
We don't know.
No, we don't know.
Goes on to say, Austrian combat Tupperware. Lol, LT is on a roll tonight, I see. Smiley face.
Yep.
And of course, the last comment is, I just don't trust the algorithm. Fair.
Yeah. Good old YouTube.
Yep.
All right. So let's get to the first of the episodes that we're going to talk about tonight. Season 6, episode 11, titled The Holding, written by Channing Powell. Now, I was going to say a lot about Channing Powell, but for brevity's sake, I won't. Except to say that she is a consulting producer and former co-executive producer of The Walking Dead, and has co-written or written 18 episodes of The Walking Dead, going from season 4 to season 9, and then she did one episode in season 10. directed by Casey Colwell, who has had a lot of time on both Fear the Walking Dead and The Walking Dead as a first assistant director. Served as that in that position for 17 episodes of The Walking Dead and 19 episodes of Fear. And she has also directed season 5, episode 11, You're Still Here, which I believe was the episode where Alicia and Morgan finally meet Wes. The description, according to AMC, is an infiltration turns rescue mission as members of the group dig deeper into an underground community. All right, so for our first episode, and then we'll get into the second episode later, what would you give The Holding, LT, out of 10?
Well, I gave it an 8 out of 10. Nope, just don't see it.
I'll also give it an 8, and I'll give it an 8 mechanically separated walkers. So, all right, so we have some listener ratings.
Okay, Glennis from Toronto says, 8 out of 10, Walker Tree of Life.
Renee from Atlanta, and I was trying to decide whether or not to put all of this in the feedback or put it all in the rating. And since she wrote it as the rating, I put it as the rating. She says, ooh, cha, thanks so much. I went on a mini vacay and I didn't get to watch it until I got back on Tuesday, and it was late and I got all in my feelings because I thought I missed the feedback. Eye roll emojis. So I'm extremely happy you guys extended it until Wednesday. Well, we extended it beyond the extended. So she gave it 10 out of 10. Don't mess with Alicia. And that comes with a strong arm emoji, strong arm emoji, strong arm emoji, and flexing muscle strong arm emoji.
All right. Dieta from Detroit says, I rate this episode 9 out of 10. Don't mess with Alicia because she will kick ass first and then ask questions.
And then to compare, Aaron from the internet simply rates this episode boring. All right. So let's move on to our awesome sauce.
Awesome sauce.
All right. Well, Dieta from Detroit says, Alicia, I loved her in this episode. Nothing but badassness the whole episode.
Glennis from Toronto says a couple things. She says, that Alicia fight ending with a mummified formaldehyde kill. Yep. Yeah, that was actually a pretty cool kill. Wes seeing his brother Derek still alive. And then Renee from Atlanta says, Alicia, period. She's a badass who does not play. Don't let them pretty doe eyes fool you. She will not go down without a fight. If you think you're going to kill me, I'm telling you it's not going to happen. Paraphrasing. And similarly to Glennis, she says, Wes reconnecting with his brother.
Okay. Aaron from the internet says, this is mainly awesome, but a mix of sad sauce also. Alicia with the match in the scene near the end totally made me think of Madison with the flare at the ballpark. Also, her beating up the big man at the end was awesome. Again, no killing Alicia show unless you want to kill your series. If they kill Alicia, fear is officially gone because it's about a family surviving and that family will be dead with her. Yes, Stranded Daniel currently still around, but the old series as we know it would for sure be gone without Alicia there to remind people this started with the Clarks. And now I'm sad thinking about how far this series has fallen.
All right, LT, what do you have for awesome sauce?
Well, I got to thinking about it and I said, okay, we have a fully functional enclave of survivors with all sorts of cool processes to grow and make food and have power and have security, but
yep,
they're the bad guys.
Yep.
What is it about only the bad guys have viable groceries and power and dry roofs over their head?
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing to say that what they were doing couldn't have been used for the good guys. I mean,
yeah.
I mean, it is kind of gross, but
yeah.
But
I just thought it was really cool that they had, you know, they've got a place that's secure and dry, and they've got grow lights, and they're growing food, and they're doing all this stuff. And I'll gripe about this later, but they have to be a whacked out cult.
Yes. Yes, of course they do.
And then, of course, for awesome sauce, I had to say, our crew doing what our crew does.
Yes, I agree with that.
Because I will have to agree that you get Alicia and the gang in there. They're not going to change. They're going to stick to what they think. And of course, the good guys are the disruption.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, kind of mentioned before already, but I guess the embalmed walkers, I thought that was very cool. Is this the first time that we've actually had confirmation that an embalmed walker actually is a walker? Like if you are embalmed, that you won't, because I always thought that if you died and were embalmed, that you would not turn into a walker. But
right.
I guess that is no longer the case.
Remember, we still had our old lady in the funeral home on the main show.
That's why I thought that was the case.
Yeah. And the only argument I would make against that was that seeing what they did, knowing that the embalming process was sort of their torture method, you could make the argument that they weren't dead and were embalmed. They were killed by the embalming. So if you wanted to make a fine point on it, then you'd say, well, no, having a dead person who was embalmed is different than making someone dead by embalming.
I suppose you're right.
If you want to put a fine point on it, but
right.
I still agree with you that the embalmed walkers was a pretty cool touch.
It was. I thought so. Also, I thought John Glover as kind of the Manson-like, or at least that's kind of what he looked like.
Yeah.
Very dirty. That's one thing I noticed about him, which I thought was kind of funny because I didn't see the rest of them all kind of dirty. He was
the only one that was really grubby.
He was really grubby. Anyway, I felt like he was really creepy in the role, and I look forward to seeing him in hopefully the next four episodes.
Seeing him be creepy again.
Yeah.
And I think I referred to him because he was on, wasn't he on Smallville as Lex Luthor's dad?
Yep.
And he had that same vibe going then as the evil businessman. But I definitely have to say that with him, you know, with the frizzy out hair looking like Charlie Manson, he definitely brought it. He's got that look in his eye, man. He can pull the, you know, the crazed authoritarian villain off. That's sort of like his thing.
And it's, you know, it's funny. I remember how he used to look like, I was thinking of, I think it was called Invasive Procedures. It was an episode of DS9 where he played a character that took over the Dax symbiont. And compared to this character, that character was very fastidious and like well groomed and well tailored, and you know, like everything I've seen of him up until a point, he was always like well groomed, and now now he's like the opposite. which I think works in his case. So, yeah, he's
but
got,
like I said, he definitely has the character. I don't want to say gravitas, but he has the character chops to play that part so well.
He does. Yeah. And he, like you say, he has a history of playing bad guys with dimension, you know, so to them.
That charismatic sort of thing.
Yeah. And yeah, so he's great in the role. I kind of knew he would be as soon as, you know, I saw his, because I recognized him, but I thought, man, I don't ever remember him looking like this. But yeah, anyway, he's great in the role, and I'm sure he's going to be great in the episodes to come.
And he's got that, you know, he's got that, I haven't had a haircut COVID look going. So it definitely worked for the survivors.
Yep. All right. So that's it for our awesome sauce. So let's move on to weak sauce for the first of our two episodes.
You're worthless and weak.
And just to clarify that, you'll be hearing these for both episodes. So
anyway. That is correct.
Yes.
So we'll start off our weak sauce with Aaron from the internet. If you like Wes or have more care than confusion over this new bad guy group, then I can see how this episode was more enjoyable for you. But as for me, I was personally looking for more badass female scenes in this based off the promo for the episode. Luciana, who was like a fighting badass in season 2, never made a move. Frowny face. Yes, Alicia and Al did some stuff, but not nearly as much as I thought they'd do this week. So the promotion of the episode versus what we got is my weak sauce this week. Okay, so on to our weak sauce.
LT, what do you have for weak sauce?
So the only question I have, we saw the composters, we saw all the grow lights, we saw all the plants. So where are the generators?
Yes.
Where, oh, where did all this electrical current come from that are powering the lights and powering the composters and powering the embalming pumps and powering all the things that need power? I mean, if they're underground, does that mean they have solar panels upstairs? Did they, I mean, it just like, I don't understand.
Yeah, that's a good question. I do not have an answer for that, but,
yep. And the next part of that is that must be one heck of a parking deck.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're underground like Area freaking 51. I mean, what did they do? Did they steal the FBI building? I mean, I know there's a couple buildings I've been in that have two levels of underground parking. But this is like, I was kind of doing the math in my head. I said, this is like 4 or 5 levels.
And well, I've seen that. I've seen parking garages that are like 10 levels down.
Yeah.
But still, it, you know, I can't imagine. At? Yeah.
They're not still in the middle of East Hog Knuckle, Texas. I mean, they've got to be in like Dallas or Fort Worth.
Right.
Some larger metropolitan area,
or Houston or Austin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Somewhere that's big, you know, and I know there's not a 10 level underground parking lot in Lawton.
And we have to remember that, you know, this is Rhode Island, Texas. So,
oh yeah, but still it's kind of made me go, so where exactly is this at? Just from an infrastructure, deep underground kind of thing. Yeah, just made me wonder. Because, you know, we know we're not at the dam anymore. It's just they've been out in the sticks, out in the country, you know, out in the scrublands. And now all of a sudden we're in town.
Yep. It is a question, but you know, like if they're going to drop nuclear bombs, and one could, I mean, that's what's being suggested,
Yeah.
That would have to be a pretty damn big underground parking lot. Like yeah. It would have to go down way down. Like, otherwise, you know, what's the point? Like, missile silo down.
Yeah. And that's kind of, again, was sort of where I was going with that. If they were far, if they didn't have to be really deep underground, as long as they're not in the primary, secondary,
right,
or maybe even the tertiary blast radius,
right.
But
they're in a parking garage.
They're going to have to be underground for quite some time.
Yeah.
And that will also segue into my what sauce. I have a what to go along with all of this. So, yeah, it's kind of infrastructurally speaking, where are they?
Yep. Well, yet another doomsday cult. That's what I want to start with. Have we gotten enough of these at this point? I mean, between the two shows, you know, we've gotten cannibals. We've got the crazy wolves that, you know, who knows what they were into. You've got the whisperers. You had what was her name at the vineyard? Can't even remember what her name was, but worshiping the dead, basically.
Yep.
Luciana mentioned that she was in a cult or whatever, but like, I don't know. When I think of them, I think it's more like, you know, small C cult. I didn't think that was really a cult.
Yeah.
It didn't seem that culty to me, except, you know,
not like full blown culty,
except that they, you know, fed the dead kind of thing. I guess that was a little culty, but still.
Yeah.
Not anywhere near as bad. Then you had, you know, the doomsday preppers and, So, you know, we've had a lot of these, kind of doomsday cult type things in the two shows and, you know, with the CRM, you know, who knows what they are. They may be a cult for that matter too. Enough is enough. I don't need any more doomsday cults, you know.
It's another one of their go-to tropes.
Yeah, you know, like the next thing you know, we're gonna find out that these this was mentioned on another podcast, but I'm gonna steal it. We're gonna find out that they worship the nuclear bomb and
well, that's if you're an old Fallout player, that's the Church of the Atom.
Well, I'm thinking of the Planet of the Apes sequel from,
Same thing.
Beneath the Planet of the Apes, I think it was.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, Okay. So the next part, speaking of doomsday cults, so they say to Alicia or, Teddy says, you've destroyed everything. We don't actually see what they've destroyed. And for that matter, why don't we see any of them turn into walkers? Like, that's the one thing that kind of got me is.
It's a good question.
That almost seemed COVID budget or something. We didn't see any. The destruction that was touted, we really didn't get to see anything. Like, if not even
if we blew things up, set everything on fire, where are the walkers?
Like, not even anything, you know, like a long shot visual effect or anything like that. Nothing.
Well,
so
you're underground. How much of a long shot can you have?
You could
have
saw, you know, Wes and Luciana and
Althea,
you know, running away and, you know, maybe you see, you know, some pillow of, you know, the smoke, you know, going or so, you know, or some
smoke, smoke billowing out of the ground.
Yeah. Or some big explosion or don't see any of that stuff. So,
nope.
Another thing that kind of got me, again, this might have been a COVID thing, I don't know, but there was that one exchange where Althea asks Wes, like, do you know where Derek's bunk is? And she's like, or he's like, yeah, I know where it is. Well, and then they go to Derek's bunk. Well, two things about that. We didn't see Derek and Wes go to Derek's bunk. So that seemed like a scene that was like removed. And for that matter, you know, much like we could say from last week where, you know, it's like, how come no one saw Daniel remove the guns?
Correct.
Same kind of thing. Why doesn't anyone see Wes and Althea go to Derek's bunk? It's like they go there and because it didn't look like they were completely, what's the word? They weren't completely being behind sneaky doors. It seemed like they were, it was like a semi-open area. So why didn't anybody see them?
That's a good question.
I thought so. All right. So let's move on to what sauce.
What?
I'll do the first one. Renee from Atlanta. She says, I have always been fascinated by cults because it's mind-boggling, no pun intended, that people are so quick to be controlled by someone that clearly has a couple of screws loose. These people are clearly batshit crazy, and Teddy is giving me Charles Manson, aka Helter Skelter, vibes. Why do we allow ourselves to be controlled by cults so easily before the apocalypse and after the apocalypse? Alpha, Negan, the cannibals at Terminus, etc. I don't know. Is Negan a cult?
You could make the argument.
I guess he could. Certainly a cultish leader.
Yeah.
Cult of personality, anyway. I believe how you were before the apocalypse is how you will be during the apocalypse. I would like to think I would be like Rick and his group, united as one, but still have a mind of my own. Al not telling anyone but Dwight about Beer Lady. It's time to spill the beans, Al. I mean, seriously, rolling eye face. Why do you think killing everyone up top is okay just because Teddy Bear says so? He looks like a mad scientist who likes to experiment on people, hence the embalming room. Yeah, he seems to like that embalming room. Really eating the vegetables that the dead fertilize. I would be too scared to eat any of that food.
Okay. And along those same lines, Aaron says, I know what they said in the episode about decomposition, but I still question the eating of products from zombified flesh and bone.
Yep. I do too.
Okay. All right. Where were we at?
I guess go ahead and do Dietic since I did Renee. Okay. Renee's was long. So
did we have a time jump because the last episode they were discussing looking for the underground people and Alicia was supposedly already out looking for clues or something, then boom, they're all on the elevator going down. I was like, wait, did I miss something? And when did Luciana show back up? Facepalm.
Well, she's been around. I mean, we know that in the last episode, Al and Alicia were out, but Wes and Luciana were at, you know, the settlement or whatever during the negotiations. So, you know, we can assume that they came back and went back out. That's what I took it as. All right. So now it's time for our what sauce. What do you have, LT?
Well, it goes back to what we were talking about before. Why do you have embalmed walkers? Why are you embalming walkers anyway? Are you just trying to keep them at a certain level of jerkiness so that you can put them in the composter? Or are these just the people that you've questioned and you embalmed them and hung them up to save them for later? I just wondered why you have a room full of embalmed walkers tied up.
Yeah, I don't know.
And just the other question about our underground doomsday cult domicile. So where are the air vents?
Well, I mean, you would expect them to be there because it's a parking garage.
Right. And if you're going to try to weather a nuclear exchange, you'd want some sort of air filtration going on.
Right.
But she set the fire and then everything looked smoky and black afterwards. So is the assumption, again, since we didn't see, you know, Wes and Luciana walking away from a huge plume of smoke and a fireball, are we going to assume that the fire that Alicia set with the embalmed walkers made smoke get into the air system and kill everybody downstairs? Or is this something they're just going to tease us with later? And just air circulation in general, if you're underground and you've got all these levels underground, I guess if you have a generator to run power, you can have a generator to run fans to make your fresh air.
True. Yeah.
And the other thing I was kind of whatting over was the notion of embalming as a torture implement. I guess it's, if you just want to kill them and make it as agonizing as possible, okay.
Yeah.
But it seemed like they were trying to ask them questions. And I sort of have an issue with, you know, sucking somebody's blood out and replacing it with a formaldehyde glycerol mixture of how conversational it'll make them.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like a good way to start a conversation.
Well, it might work if you have multiple people that it's like, see what we did to your buddy. If you don't talk, you're next.
Right.
So still, it just kind of, again, it just sort of segues into why I have all the embalmed walkers hanging out. It just seemed like that this was their torture / questioning method. And I just wondered, well, how much questioning are you going to get out of them that way?
Yeah. Yeah. I have in my what sauce things that we've already talked about. We talked about the embalmed walkers already. Of course, we saw them originally season 6, episode 3, Alaska. And of course, we had seen them in season 4 of The Walking Dead. I think I know it was one of the Beth Daryl episodes. I think it might have been Still, or was it might have been the episode after that. I don't know. But
yeah, it was right before she got kidnapped with the cabinet full of peanut butter.
Right. That's right.
That's what I was talking about, the very attractive dead lady.
Right. Right.
No, that was with Alicia. Excuse me. No, that was, yeah, I was thinking I'm in the wrong funeral home.
Okay.
But yeah, still, either or.
Yeah. So I guess this is conclusive, but maybe not, that you don't need blood to reanimate. I mean, I don't know. I guess it's not conclusive, because if we know that we've seen an embalmed dead person that did not come back to, you know,
yeah,
to reanimate, I guess that's not conclusive. Like, I don't know. Who knows?
This is a question for you, Kirkman. If you're listening, you are Nicotero. We want answers.
Yeah. Yeah. Or showrunners, whatever.
Anybody.
But the one thing I was going to ask, and it's a good thing for what sauce, is what do you see? Like, what's the point of that whole walker in the vines?
The walker in the kudzu?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we certainly have seen that before. Is it kind of like the kudzu is being sustained by the walker? Is that what it is? It's not like a...
I, I've had a chance to think about this, and okay. all I can figure it is the new life from death. It's kind of like the walker in the vines is sort of like their phoenix. That the old world, you know, the old order is the zombie, and the new order is the vines that have sprung forth, giving new life as nature reasserts itself from the zombie apocalypse.
Okay.
Well, and like that's I said,
that's kind of what I was thinking too.
That's the best I've got, because it's still, I'll go back to my original rating of nope, just don't see it.
Yep. All right, so let's move on to Sad Sauce.
Aww. Okay, for Sad Sauce, Dieta from Detroit says, Wes finding his brother only to lose him again to Teddy and the New Beginnings people. Oh, and Glennis from Toronto says something very similar. Wes having to end his brother Derek's life after such a short-lived reunion.
Renee from Atlanta says Wes reconnecting with his brother, then having to kill him. Crying face, crying face, and crying face. And lastly, Aaron from the internet says, this is an aw sauce for sure. Not sad. Althea and Dwight's friendship is just so cute. They're such an adorable brother and sister duo, and I want more with them. Smiley face. We don't have anything written for sad slash aw sauce, but is there anything you wanted to highlight?
I think the listeners have already beat the wheels off of that.
Yes, I agree.
That it was, after all that, Wes looking for his brother, and he finds him. But then he turns out that he's, I don't know, the apocalypse Hare Krishna.
Yep. All right, so it is now again time for our feedback section. And our second of three times that we'll play this week.
We can talk about it.
We're done talking. Time to listen.
Okay, well, Renee from Atlanta says, I love this episode. It was really suspenseful. It had a TWD prison vibe to it, and I love that season. If an outbreak happens, that's all she wrote for Teddy and his minions. I really hope Alicia does not fall for the okie dokie. I'm going to be really upset with Fear if they allow her to become indoctrinated into this mess. She better be the one who takes the cult out. Wes needs to pull them two braids that hanging up in his rest of his pony, because they're super distracting.
Yep.
Facepalm, 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 and facepalm emojis. OMG. When they had to walk through the room filled with embalmed zombies, I was so nervous, but in a good way, because I love the suspense. You know they had issues because you could not have paid me to sew those zombies' mouths shut. Angry yep. face, angry face, angry face. Oh, one other thing. Posters. Really? Have several seats that does not even sound right, nor do eaters for that matter. Facepalm, facepalm, and facepalm emojis. I'm really looking forward to the rest of the season. Love you guys. Enjoy the rest of your week, and please continue to keep India in your prayers. Praying emoji, and praying emoji. And yes, I was waiting, and I did not specifically mention this in my what sauce, because I knew that was coming up when in the feedback people would start to comment about posters. At first, yep. I was like, posters? What the heck are they talking about? It is a weird thing to call zombies, don't you think?
Well, they had their zombie on the post. So.
Oh, that's true. That's not what I was thinking it is. I was thinking it had to do with composters, you know?
Well, that could be it as well.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe. It could be either thing.
Yep.
So, anyway, thank you so much, Renee.
Thank you so much. All right, Glenn from Toronto says, the vibes of TWD Terminus, those who arrive survive, whispered through this entire episode of The Undergrounders, with that voice over the intercom brainwashing all whom are within earshot. Teddy is, as Alicia called him, king of the crazies. I hope Alicia can just pretend to go along with his ideologies and then take him down. He thinks she's converted over to their way of thinking, and when he least suspects it.
I don't know why he would think that so quickly, though. I mean,
nah.
Maybe he will think that, and then
maybe he wants to think that.
Yeah.
They want to locate Morgan as he has the missing key, which I still think is part of two keys needed in order to launch that sub's nuke and kill all life above ground.
Yeah. And
yes. Just
so everyone's all of this feedback was collected prior to the second episode that we're going to discuss. So
just. Yep. She goes on to say, chicken meal made from crunched up walker or poster bones. Yum. Chicken head.
Yeah.
Fear the Walking Dead writers, etc., are teasing us again with all the mention of the CRM group. Rick, please step forward. Smiley face. So Al is off on a mission to find Isabel of said CRM group and warn her about these crazy undergrounders. I kept seeing Fear the Walking Dead Teddy as Lionel Luther from Smallville. At times I found it hard to differentiate between these two characters. Maybe Clark Kent will save the day.
Thank you, Glynis, for your feedback as usual. Next is Dieta from Detroit. She says, also commenting about this, so they call the dead posters Thinking Face and Thinking Face. Not sure about that one. Me either, actually.
Yep.
Happy crying face, happy crying face. Loved it when Al said we can come back to that one. Yeah, I like that too, actually. Our group getting all the underground people's secrets on how they maintain everything, like turning the dead into fertilizer to grow stuff. But is that safe, though? Thinking emoji.
That's a mask face and then a
masking face.
Nauseous, yeah. A nauseous face.
Yes. And two question marks. I guess, shrug emoji. Teddy. Who is he and what is fate? He has everybody running around like they're in a cult. Well, I think they're in a cult.
Yes.
Teddy said this. Teddy said that. We have to see what Teddy sees. And those are big eyes. Teddy's voice playing over a loudspeaker over and over. Everybody running to the elevator, smiling. And crazy smile with the tongue hanging out emoji. Where's Teddy? All this screaming cult behavior to me. I'm just saying. And if you don't go along with what Teddy says, you become an embalmed poster. Rolling over, laughing, crying face. And laughing, crying face. And crying, laughing face. Why does everyone have to be the creator of New World Order and everyone else must follow me if you want to survive? Well, that does seem to be the thing, doesn't it?
Yes, it is.
Morgan has the key, but how do they know Morgan has the key? He killed the attackers who came after him, and as far as I know, nobody else has said anything else until now. I was thinking about this. I think they know because, what's his name at the beginning? Emil. Yeah. He had the key and he got, Morgan got the key from Emil. Those two guys that went after Morgan knew Morgan had the key.
Right.
And then, I don't know. And then, you know, for that matter,
I assume that since the underground people knew so much about what Jenny was doing, I figure they have a mole in Lawton. So they know that Emil had the key and that Morgan killed Emil because Jenny was trying to kill Morgan.
I wouldn't be surprised if it's that Hill guy. Because I think Hill is still alive, isn't he?
Yes, he is.
Or it could be Samuels, the Jenny lookalike.
That could be too. Or it could just be somebody else.
Yes, somebody else. That's a good way to put
unknown,
it.
Unknown Lawtonite.
Yeah. Let's see. Wes's brother is brainwashed by Teddy and the underground people. I can't believe he plotted to kill his own brother at the dam. Well, that was at Tank Town. Just,
yeah.
It just to clarify, still, he did plot to kill his own brother. The end is the beginning, especially for Derek. I bet he didn't see that coming. Rolling over laughing emoji, rolling over laughing emoji. Al and her obsession about the triple O people looking for her boo thing to come back, not telling anybody what she knows about the mystery helicopter that nobody has seen or heard. But wait, didn't Dwight know when she went to the roof to leave but stayed instead? Neither of them failed to mention that or the case of antibiotics and beer. Overall, it was an all right episode, but it still felt like it was jumping all over the place. Well, okay. Thank you so much, Dieta.
And we have more feedback from Aaron from the internet, who says, boring. It definitely felt like more work to get through this episode than it has the last three. Maybe it was the dragging out of information, or again, how the girls disappointingly didn't do as much as I was hoping, or the fact you could tell the moment Wes and his brother stepped in front of the tree zombie, that was what Wes would use to kill him. But this episode just lacked excitement to any degree. I don't have much hope for next week either, honestly, but maybe we'll pick up again with later coming episodes.
Yes, we may. All right, so that's it for our feedback for the first episode tonight. Do you have anything else you want to bring up for the holding?
No, I don't.
Just a brief thing I want to say is we have another connection to the Terminator universe, and that is Nick Stahl, who of course plays Riley, who we actually see in both episodes tonight. And I should say this morning, this episode that you're listening to. He played John Connor in Terminator 3 Rise of the Machines, which
yes, he did.
Yeah. Yeah. So, that one you don't hear too much about, but I enjoyed that one. I thought that was better than the fourth one.
Yeah.
So
I would argue that they crested at 2.
Yeah, of course they did. Yeah. Yeah. Definitely 3 was not as good as 2. 2 was the
longer,
best one.
The longer we've gone on, just to steal that phrase from the blue box people, it got a little too timey-wimey.
Yeah. Yeah. Like that last one was very timey-wimey. Although I haven't seen the very last one, the one that had Linda Hamilton back in it.
Yeah.
I haven't seen that one yet. I did see the one with, what's her name from Game of Thrones. Anyway. So, yeah, and the reason why I bring up Terminator, of course, is Garrett Dillahunt played a Terminator in the Sarah Connor Chronicles, if you didn't know that. And the beginning of the episode actually reminded me a lot of the cold open from Season 3, Episode 3, Teotwaki, because it had that kind of recorded, you know, vibe at the beginning. Yeah. So that's what it reminded me of. All right. So now we move on to our second episode of this recording. Season 6, episode 12, the very differently in every way, I would say.
Yes.
In Dreams, written by the showrunners, Andrew Chambliss and Ian Goldberg, and someone else, I think the co-executive producer, I need to go and confirm that. Nazrin Choudhury, I think.
Yeah.
I think that's how you say it. And directed by co-executive producer Michael E. Satrazemis. The description according to AMC, is Grace wakes up with a case of amnesia, seeing what's become of her friends after she has been gone for years. She struggles to put the puzzle pieces together on what has transpired. I would say that is kind of deceptive.
I would say so.
Yes. All right. So what would you give In Dreams?
Well, I'm giving it 8 out of 10. If I hear Roy Orbison, I get a headache. And I love Roy Orbison, but after this week, Roy's given me a headache.
I'm going to give this one a 9.5 out of 10. And it, in a lot of ways, it would have given me a 10, but I think it was so much of a downer that I can't, I have to deduct a half point just because, you know, it's not a feel good episode in the end. Well, it kind of was for so much of it. And then, you know, right at the end, kind of like, you know, pulling the tablecloth from the table. So I'm going to give it 9.5 out of 10. What Dreams May Come, because that's what it reminded me of, the Robin Williams movie.
Yep, I think I can see that.
And if you haven't seen that movie, it's really good. But it had a very similar kind of use of color in the dream state. So, anyway. All right, so let's move on to listener ratings. LT?
Okay, Aaron from the internet says, I was prepared to give this episode an okay for the rating, but then the literal last 2 minutes happened, and so it's getting a boo instead for issues listed above.
Deanna gives it 8 out of 10 sad sauces with crying emoji, and crying emoji.
Glenn from Toronto gives it a 9 out of 10. I'm right here.
And Renee from Atlanta gives it a 10 out of 10. Aw, Athena, really crying emoji, really crying emoji, really crying emoji, really crying emoji, and really crying emoji. So, in other words, more crying, bawling your eyes out emoji, I guess you could also call it.
Yep.
Let's move on to our awesome sauce. Aaron from the internet is first. She says, once again, the one thing for sure the episode has going for it is the visuals. I also really enjoyed Dream Daniel and Victor bickering like a married couple over the haircut quality, smiley face. Yeah, it was good to see them getting along. Too bad it was in a dream.
Yep. Deanna from Detroit says, the double kill in the stable dream scene with Grace and Athena and Morgan and the underground guy. Loved how the stories blended during the fight scene.
Renee from Atlanta says, the scenery was so beautiful. The cinematography was amazing and absolutely jaw-dropping. I have so many other superlatives I could use, but you guys get it. Heart-loving face, heart-loving face, heart-loving face. I'm an outdoorsy person, so I'm super in tuned with nature. That's why I give this episode a 10 out of 10. Yeah, I thought it was cool as well.
Yeah. Okay. Glenn from Toronto says, it was awesome meeting Athena and seeing what might have been 16 years later with Morgan's community thriving and Strand and Daniel getting along and Dwight and Sherry back together and June the doctor. Just makes it that much more painful knowing that it will never be. But the dream could still be a reality for Dwight and Sherry. Nothing's stopping that from happening, still with them getting back together.
Yeah, I agree. All right, LT, what do you have for awesome sauce?
Well, my awesome sauce was, I have to give some backhanded compliments to the writers. Even though I struggled with part of the episode and the way that they did the whole dream sequence amnesia thing, I think that they did a good job at, you know, suspending some of my disbelief and sort of setting the stage of her, you know, Grace's dream and all the stuff she experienced. And then, you know, sort of like what Aaron said, the last 2 minutes, you get the smack in the face and happy Mother's Day. So
yeah, happy Mother's Day. Yeah.
So, I mean, I think the problem I have is not with the way it was written or the way it was executed. It was just the story just got me in all the wrong ways there towards the end.
And I could totally understand that. And I think I had a little bit of a discussion. Well, not so much in a discussion as much as an exchange. I think if you were a family person and, you know, especially if you had young children, I think that this may have affected you one way. And if you weren't, it may have affected you another way. Because in my case, I've talked about this before, I don't really have any children that are in my life, really. So it doesn't look like I'll ever have kids or ever have even, you know, nieces and nephews. So, you know, it's just not something that is in my purview. So I just, that part of the episode didn't really hurt me. Like, I think it hurt some people.
Yes.
Yeah. And I understand why it hurt some people. I get that. Believe me, I do. I guess it's because I'm detached from it. Right. I didn't feel it. So, you know, that's what I mean. Was already mentioned about the beautiful, you know, visual effects, the cinematography. I agree with Renee when she said that, and I think others, you know, Aaron said it as well.
Yep.
I thought the performance of Karen David, and I was going to look her up. Young woman that played Athena, Karen David, and we now know Grace's full name, and hopefully I'll get the name right. Grace Mukherjee. That's my best guess. And then I had to look up her name, Sahana Srinivasan, who was, of course, playing Athena Mukherjee. So I thought both of them did a great job in those roles, especially Karen David. Karen David hasn't had a lot, especially in this season. She really hasn't had much to go on. I mean, we didn't even see her until, what, episode 7, I think?
Yeah.
And just barely at the beginning of episode 7, or at the end of episode 7. So she hasn't had much this season, so it was good for her to finally have an episode to shine, and she definitely did shine bright this episode. So
yeah.
All right. So that's it for our awesome sauce. So let's move on to weak sauce.
You're worthless and weak.
All right. I guess
Aaron from the internet says, I know Morgan has the plot armor to end all plot armor, but seriously, I am so over bad guys with guns not shooting the person and just taking what they want. Seriously. You're supposed to be evil. Shoot them.
Yep. It's funny that you bring up that point about you're supposed to be evil. Shoot them. Because this came up. I was just at random. My podcast backlog is so far back. I am still in my podcast player playing episodes that go back to March of 2020. I'm not kidding. So I heard an episode, and strangely enough, it was an episode of me and Ruthie talking about, and this was playing when I woke up this morning, season 1, episode 8 of Star Trek Picard, titled Broken Pieces. And we were talking about how refreshing it was for a villain to not be a Bond villain, to, not go on a 5-minute dialogue of what they were going to do to kill you, and instead just shot. And the character of Narissa in Picard was very much that kind of bad guy, if you could call her that, villain who just, just shot.
Yep. No monologue.
No monologue. No, no kind of, what's the word? Posturing. She was a bad person through and through, and, didn't apologize for it. Just, it was kind of like, oh, I've got a good reason to kill people. That's what we said in that episode.
She did.
Yeah, because she did. Anyway, so it's just funny that this comes up, because it was the same point that I heard me and Ruthie say just today when I was doing something from 15 or 14 months ago.
Yep.
And yes, I do listen to my own stuff, and I do that to criticize myself. So, because I want to know how I sound, and I'll even go back to stuff from, the before time to see how I did. And I listened to it today and I thought, man, we were good. I thought, what the hell has happened to me? I'll tell you what's happened to me. COVID and the stuff I talked about at the beginning of this episode. That's what's happened to me. It was before all of that.
Yeah.
It's before I went nuts. So anyway.
Okay. Also, can we talk about how weak it was for a moment that after everything, they killed the baby because of assumed radiation, but they didn't kill the baby via shooting Grace earlier in the season to up Jenny's villain factor.
Mm.
I know Jenny was never really the villain the group hyped her up to be, but still, this could have added some pop to that if she had shot Grace in the lineup. They were going to kill the kid anyways, as it turns out, so why not let the actress be free also? As Grace herself says, she's not going to get better from the radiation poisoning, so she's going to die. Also, so you could knock out two people in that one move.
Not true. Not true. Supposedly, there is a thing where the radiation in pregnant women, for whatever reason, gets goes to the fetus. So apparently that was a thing that was seen in Chernobyl and all that stuff. Something I did not realize, but when it was brought up this episode, I looked it up. So
okay, well, it's the same reason you have alcoholic babies and heroin addict babies.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. Aaron goes on to say, also, I'm going to be that person and ask, if the baby was dead, why did it not turn into a zombie and bite Grace from the inside? I know Grace says in the end they were Athena's final moments, but if it's a baby, so if anyone turns instantly, wouldn't it be it? I'm just saying the last 3 minutes were ultra weak until they happened. I had no weak sauce, which was speaking well for the episode, but so much for that. And I have to say, that was kind of, you stole my thunder, Aaron. But I think I whatted that instead of weaked it. So
I was wondering that myself. In fact, I was reminded of Z Nation, where we see a zombie baby, and I won't give any more than that.
Okay.
Because that could be spoiler for people.
Yep, yep,
but
yep.
But at some point in Z Nation, they show a zombie baby. That I think I can say.
Yep. And I'll ramble about that later. Not Z Nation, but the zombie babies.
All right. LT, what do you have for weak sauce?
Well, as listeners to the podcast are well aware, I'm just not a fan of flashback-ish episodes. And that was my whole problem. It was just the, again, I like the way they wrote it, but I just found myself going, you know, is she tripping? Is she hallucinating? You know, and of course, it's actually not a flashback episode. Okay. It's nope. It's a flash forward episode.
And it's not even that. It's a dream flash forward.
It's a dream. So that was kind of my thing, is that it was the whole flash forwardy backy dream sequence thing.
It's an alternate future, actually.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, I'm going to go with the most obvious thing, and I don't think this was done by design, because I don't believe that this would have aired on this day, but it is quite the episode for Mother's Day.
Indeed.
Yeah. You know, obviously, if COVID had not happened, it would not have played on Mother's Day, but you had to think, it's like, did they really have to play this on Mother's Day? Because, you know, I mean, there's actually some, I know Renee had a point that she's going to bring up later, which I think will be an interesting take on it. And she has a take on it that, you know, I think people want to hear. But okay. Still, yeah, Mother's Day, not exactly a great time for an episode like this with that ending where,
yep,
you know, and mind you, you know, if the mother had died, you know, if Grace had died and Athena had lived, that wouldn't have been great either. But I think for any mother to lose, you know, her baby like this, I think on a Mother's Day, it seems pretty hard. So,
yep.
But anyway, stay tuned for that other take. And I think you guys will find it interesting. The only other thing I'll say for week is there were some characters that were missing, most notably Alicia, which I think Alicia, Althea, and Wes. And my thoughts about those three is they didn't keep them in because they would have been the hardest to do 16 years later. And, you know, mind you, they had Sherry and, you know, she's pretty young. So
yeah,
doing her 16 years later, I don't know why it was easy for them to do Sherry, but not so easy to do Alicia. But, you know, then again, you have Wes who, you know, his hair is probably going to change a lot in 16 years. Althea, I could see her looking a lot different in 16 years,
mm-hmm.
You know? So anyway, I appreciated the characters that they did. I thought, honestly, I thought, Morgan was kind of goofy, you know, it was kind of like, you know, glued on
the white hair,
curly hair.
I'm trying to remember. He looked like, I can't remember. He looked like the makeup they did for Samuel L. Jackson it might have been Django Unchained.
Okay.
But just seeing Morgan with the shockingly white hair and the shocking white beard.
Yeah. I mean, to me,
if you're old enough to remember when Disney still released Song of the South, he kind of had that.
Yeah, it was like that.
Very Uncle Remus.
So his hair didn't look very realistic, but I appreciated the fact that they had him in there.
Right.
I would have liked to have seen the other three characters. I mean, we got to see Daniel and Strand. We didn't see them too close up, you know, but we saw them, you know, and maybe they could have done that with Alicia and Althea and Wes, you know, I don't know. I think Wes would have been the most difficult of the three, to be honest.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's it for our weak sauce. Let's move on to what sauce.
What?
Aaron from the internet says, so let's pretend Athena had lived. Where exactly does Grace think they're going to get good quality batteries 16 years later in order for that tape player to work? I know this is magical Rhode Island, Texas, and there's probably some around every corner they bend down to conveniently look at, but still, that was just a laughable concept, smiley face.
Yeah.
And well, it definitely wasn't rechargeable, so.
No.
And we didn't see any power in the little settlement anyway, so.
And you could also argue that 16-year-old cassette tape being played over and over again, so.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we have some feedback from Dieta from Detroit. She says, Morgan, you are not the father. Wait, what they had us thinking Grace and Morgan had a lot of fun at the mall when they were temporarily stranded there?
Obviously not that much fun.
That's the chin-scratching face. Then we get Grace, unconscious, telling a story about she got pregnant by her radiation boo before running into the group. Facepalm. Wait, does this timeline even add up? And why did they not let Morgan be the baby daddy? I was sitting here like, wait a minute. What, Grace is pregnant by somebody else? Was I the only one shocked by this piece of news? And it's like, shocked face, eye rolling, and shrug.
Well, I mean, for me, that's kind of why when I brought up the point about their, how they're kind of subdued in their romantic, you know, they're not really romantic. It's like they love each other, but we never see them kiss or anything like that.
Right.
So they are, but we do see that, and we know from last season, but that's the problem. It was last season where it was last brought up that Grace had a boyfriend prior to the apocalypse, and it was mentioned that, you know, she had a relationship or something, but
right.
But yeah, and we've never seen Morgan and Grace, you know, do the nasty, so.
Getting busy.
Mm-hmm.
But the question that I have, if we're going to talk about the dead boyfriend, is so from the time they were at the truck at the nuke plant until now has only been 9 months?
Yeah, it seems that way.
Okay. There seemed to be a whole lot going on for that just to be 9 months.
Yeah, definitely. Renee from Atlanta also has some what sauce. Seriously, Morgan, why didn't you kill Riley when you had the chance? Stop with the whole freaking we don't kill mess. rolling eyes face.
And that would be correct because he killed everybody else.
All right. What do you have for your what sauce?
Well, I didn't want to go into the whole zombie baby thing, but I will because I must. We'd already talked about this, and Brian, you and I have had a long talk about how fast does it take for someone who's recently expired to become a zombie. We've talked about, well, it's the speed of plot. They turn yes. as fast as they need to.
We have definitely talked about this in the past.
And it just seems like to me that we're back to the whole thing of we know that when people die, they become zombies. And I know that Aaron talked about it before, you know, when did the baby die? How long was the baby dead in utero, so to speak? Did it have a chance to turn there? Did we wait till it got out? It just, I mean, I know that they had the whole touching moment. I know that that's what it was for, to show that her dream was just a dream. But I can't think that I'm not the only person that was expecting little dead baby to start going, you know,
yep.
when he laid it on her chest. And I'm glad they didn't, because I think that would be just way over the top, even for them.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still the question of, you know, how long is it going to be before they're going to have to, you know, do the head thing to the baby?
Yeah.
And
yeah,
that was still my point of it's that variable time frame of how long does it take for you to become a zombie? And the answer is always as long as it needs to be.
Yeah. The speed of plot, as you say.
Yep. And the other what sauces I had, I will share with the audience what I wrote in the notes. It's jerk my heartstrings again, you bastards. Because I was, you know, it's sort of the converse of what you had said, you know, having kids, having been, you know, intimately involved in the delivery of both of mine. And it just that after all the dreams and all the stuff that happened and all the Roy Orbison, then just that scene of her post-delivery and with Morgan doing CPR in the background, and then the whole her crying and holding the baby and the whole cutaway fade back, just it got me. I mean, it was an emotional moment for Fear. And I can't say that I disliked it from the standpoint of the overall story, but it's like, thanks for the gut punch, guys. That we go through this whole thing, we meet a character who is just a dream character, and then you get that last slap there at the end. It was a little much. And of course, I will have to go ahead and say it, since somebody else did. Morgan, you killed the three sidekicks, but you didn't kill the last guy. You know, this is not... I can't remember what movie now, but this is not, I'm leaving you alive. No, this is like I think it was maybe 300. The, I'm leaving you alive so you can go tell your people that I killed all your buddies. If you're going to kill them, kill them. You know, don't give him a chance to nobly run away wounded, because he's going to come back.
Yeah.
And so that's about it for me.
I was just going to say, similar to the things that you've said, geez, do you like Roy Orbison much, showrunners?
Yeah.
It just seems like, you know, there's been a whole, first there were traveling Wilbury stuff. Now there's a whole Roy Orbison thing going on. So I don't know if they've got a line into the Roy Orbison estate.
Or if maybe they've got a deal with their record
company. Yeah. Yeah. And of course, that obviously included the Traveling Wilburys. But yeah. So I don't know. I think they need to give it a rest.
I'm sensing a theme here.
There's definitely a theme. But anyway, all right. So that's all I've got. Let's move on to our sad/aw sauce.
Aww. Okay, and we'll start with Aaron from the internet. While it ends up amounting to almost nothing, arguably the line, "I don't think you're going to get the chance to know me," was a good one. Also sad this week is the fact that none of the characters I super care about were in the episode. Yeah, June and Dwight were in it for a second, as were Strand and Victor, but they didn't really have anything to do beyond their quick scenes, and there was no Alicia or Al. Speaking of Alicia, though, all to the fact she fixed up the ball field and found Madison alive. Yeah, I'm headcanoning that. I feel you, Alicia. I'd run from Morgan if I could, too.
Ouch. All right. Next is Glynis from Toronto. She says, that ending was so hard, as during the episode, I had resigned myself to the fact, quote unquote, that Grace was going to die. That plot twist was like a knife to the head of a walker that will never see Athena grow up and be that strong, beautiful daughter trained by Morgan in the art of the bow and carrying on the legacy of her mother, Grace. I agree.
Indeed. And Renee from Atlanta says, I have had several miscarriages and I was absolutely devastated after each one. So I can only imagine how it would feel to carry a baby full term and for that baby to be born stillborn. Mm. And she has four crying faces emojis. I applaud FTWD for going there because it's such a touchy subject, but it helps to know that you're not the only one. A lot of people were saying it should not have aired on Mother's Day, but it's like it doesn't matter when it would have aired. It would have still been a sad episode.
True.
To me, it was realistic because of Grace being exposed to the radiation.
Mm.
Athena was so cute and sweet, and the way she used the stick like her dad, Morgan. Is that Babaji?
Babaji.
Babaji. I hate that she didn't survive. I definitely knew that it was not Morgan's biological child because Grace talked about having a fling with someone when they were at the facility and that he died from the radiation, and I never saw her and Morgan consummate their relationship.
Indeed. That is my take on it as well.
Yep.
Renee, very sad to hear about the miscarriages. I'm sure that was difficult to go through. Thank you for sharing. And as I've tried to do, I think sharing seems to, it seems to help. I know it helps me. And yeah. Like I said, I don't know how much of what I said is going to air, but it definitely felt good saying those things, even though, as I said, it doesn't point me in the best light. It's one of those things that's, you know, once you get it out in the open, it's there, man.
It's out in the open.
Yeah. Believe me, I know what I did was wrong, and I don't feel good about it at all. And I will regret it for the rest of my life. You know, I know, I'm pretty sure I'll never be forgiven for it. It's unfortunate, but, you know, maybe someday, but I don't get that, vibe from her. So I better not expect it. Did you have anything else you wanted to mention here?
Everybody else is already fine. I think I would just be adding to the awe.
Yeah.
I talked about it. Just the whole end just really hit me hard. So
yeah, it was hard to deal with, and I felt that I didn't see it coming. So when it hit, it hit me pretty hard. As I said, you know, for me, I don't have anything to go by on this. It's not, you know, I don't have anything that, you know, shares this, but, you know, I did feel it was tragic, I thought. And I thought for sure, you know, once this episode got started, this was going to be, you know, oh, it's Grace's last episode.
Yeah. You know,
that's what I was expecting right from the beginning. And instead it was a complete shock at the end. So, you know, I thought for that, it was an effective episode, but, also a very tragic episode. And, you know, some of the best, episodes in this universe are the ones like this. Like I can think of, season 3, you know, the episode from The Walking Dead where Lori and T-Dog died. I mean,
yep.
Both that had a similar kind of thing with that. That episode started and had no idea at all that episode was going to end with Lori dying. And that one had a very similar, I mean, the opposite kind of end, but very, you know, similar kind of vibe to it. So, all right. So anyway, let's get to our listener feedback. The last time you'll hear this tonight.
We can talk about
it. Done talking. Time to listen.
All right. Dead from Detroit says, I actually liked Grace's dream version of our people. Everybody was getting along and growing the community Morgan started. It was so nice. Dr. Dory and Nurse Charlie, Daniel the barber getting along with Victor. That was funny. Sherry and Dwight had babies. And then Athena, daughter of Grace, definitely looked like a young Grace. I definitely wasn't expecting the end to be what it was, a real sad tearjerker. I can't believe Grace lost the baby and Morgan lost the key. Was the loss of Athena tied to the key? In the dream, Athena had the key around her neck, but since Morgan gave it up because Grace said he was supposed to, then Athena wouldn't have the key because he gave it up. I don't know. I'm just trying to make it make sense. Overall, it was an okay episode. How is Grace going to be after her loss, and is she going to die from her supposed radiation poisoning? Morgan fell in love with Grace before he found out she was pregnant. How is this going to affect their relationship?
That, I don't know. Like I've said, we've yet to see them kiss. Have we? I don't remember them ever kissing.
I don't think they have.
I don't, you know, it makes me wonder, is this like a Lenny James thing? You know, like, does he have like a jealous wife or something in real life?
I don't know. It could be. You could make the argument that nobody's kissing because of COVID protocols.
That's true.
They've done a lot of hugging, but then again, they were getting all googly eyed at each other before the pandemic. So,
yeah, I mean, maybe we would have seen them kiss before.
You said, maybe it is a Lenny James thing. I don't know.
Yeah. I would be curious to know. I don't know anything. I didn't get a chance to like watch the thing that is on AMC, and I haven't figured out where that stuff is on AMC Plus yet. I still have AMC Plus, by the way. I ended up signing up for the month with Amazon because I liked it a lot better than I liked the Roku version. So
you're talking about, what was the name of it? The Lenny James British cop show.
No.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah, I know he's got one. Yeah.
That was on AMC. That was the only other thing I've seen him.
Oh, that one. Yes. Actually, that took place in Detroit. I don't remember the name of that one, but yes. Yeah. Yeah, that actually took place in Detroit and actually had some scenes in Windsor, my hometown.
Okay.
So, yeah. And it showed Windsor to be a very crime-infested place. Like, I don't think it's that crime-infested. I mean, yes, it's next to Detroit, so, you know.
Yeah, well.
So it's got some crime for sure, but it's not Detroit crime. Anyway. Okay. So, Glynis from Toronto is next. And if I've said anything out of turn, Windsorites that listen to us, and I know there are a few, you can correct me. It's been a while since I've been back. Anyway, Glynis says, what is going to happen now that Grace persuaded Morgan to give up the key? when thinking falsely that her dream was actually going to come true and Athena was the sort of peace weapon that the group would prosper in spite of the end the underground crazies were planning. And in a lot of ways, I think that this might end up being the saddest part of what happened in this episode. We'll see, you know, if that ends up being, but she just so convincingly, was basically, yelling, give him the key, give him the key. And he did. And, it turned out for nothing,
Yep. So,
and we pretty much know what they're going to do. They're going to use the keys to try to blow stuff up,
And I'm still thinking what they're going to try to do, because they're still going to have to clear the submarine.
And they still have to do this whole submarine thing that they have been talking about that they haven't shown yet.
Yep.
I haven't forgotten that. And I don't think you have either.
Oh, no. They owe us the special episode miniseries thing.
Yeah, and I'm not sure why they haven't shown it yet. I guess maybe they're waiting for things to get to a certain part in the season where they don't want to spoil anything. I don't know. But anyway, next. The group is now in an even more precarious position because of Grayson Morgan, too, to a certain degree, as he didn't kill Riley when he dispatched the other cronies in quick time.
Exactly.
Yep. You always got to let the bad guy go. The group will now have to go on a mission to get that key or keys back. Otherwise, that nuke is going to be launched, which seems they will come up with a plan since we do have season 7 waiting in the wings, unless it's drawn out with these underground folks into season 7. Yeah.
It's possible.
Either one is possible. I should have realized that the appearance of that white horse wouldn't bode well for a good outcome in Grace's dream. The last time we saw a white horse was when Rick Grimes was thrown onto the stake and then whisked away by the end of the episode by that CRM helicopter in TWD season 9, episode 5. That white horse has been cantering ever since and arrived in Texas just in time to be manifested into Grace's dream within a dream from Grace seeing that horse painting. I'm right here, mantra that Morgan was saying when his wound was deterring the walkers in season 6, episode 1. Now, even Grace is saying it. Next will be the clock. Okay, I have to laugh at this one. Next will be the classic, you know what it is, and if I had that, I would play it, but I don't.
Well, you know what it is.
Yes, you know what it is.
You know what it is.
Smiley face. I'm right here seems to shout not to look over or dismiss that person or take them for granted. They're not going to be ignored and will make their imprint on this world before they leave it. Or maybe I'm just reading too much into it and it just means, hey, I'm here. Just look this way. Smiley face.
Yep.
But it does look as if there will be a resolution to the undergrounders in this season 6 finale, going by the season 6 remaining episode titles. So if you don't like to hear this kind of thing, just skip forward 30 seconds. Season 6, episode 13, JD. Season 6, episode 14, Mom. Season 6, episode 15, USS Pennsylvania. And season 6, episode 16, The Beginning. Interesting. Maybe Grace will get their happy community ending after all, as the different groups may well put aside their differences and unite and rally around Grace in her time of sorrow, and that unity may be all that is needed to tip the scales and prevent Teddy and undergrounders annihilating above ground from happening. So Athena could have been the weapon of peace after all. Well, I hope you're right, Glynis.
Yep.
And again, thank you for your feedback.
Okay. And Renee from Atlanta says, I'm really loving Fear the Walking Dead. I've been listening to people talk about how bad it is on so many podcasts, but I totally disagree. This episode started out like, what is this mess? But as it went along, it ended up being a really jaw-dropping, sad, but real episode. After everything Grace and her baby were exposed to, I wouldn't expect either or to survive. I like that Grace was able to meet her mini-me, even if it was just a dream. I'm definitely looking forward to seeing what this cult is up to with the key. Love you guys. Have a wonderful and blessed week. Praying hands, praying hands, praying hands.
Well, thank you so much, Renee. And I want to just comment on that, too. I definitely have noticed some of the other podcasts seem to be just shitting on this season. So, I mean, LT, what's your impression of season six as a whole so far?
Well, so far, I don't think it's that bad. And This is the thing that I hope folks are taking away from I'll just speak for myself. You know, the things that I say, I may bag on particular bits of the episode, but always go back and look at my ratings. I mean, if I really dislike the whole episode, I'm not going to rate it that high. But if I rate it high, it means I like the episode, but that still does not mean that I won't, you know, turn the eye of Sauron upon the episode and find things that I want to talk about that may not necessarily always be positive things. Mm-hmm. I think that as a whole, I think, we've taken them to task on several plot points and several devices and several things they've done. But I think overall, we haven't really trashed the episodes as I can remember, you know, prior to my arrival, things that were discussed, you know, I know in previous episodes where you were down on the episode and rightly so.
Mm-hmm.
And I know a lot of folks have been really bagging hard on this season, and I will still stick by the contention that I made when we started Fear, is I'll still argue that what we've gotten in Fear, even with warts and anomalies, was still better than the added on episodes as a whole of the main show.
I agree. Yeah.
That the extra episodes we got for the main show were, let's make some content. And there were some execution things. There was some COVID-ish things that they did. And I'm glad they made episodes. I mean, maybe I could have done without most of them the way they did it. But I think that this season of Fear came out strong. And I think I'll argue that this half season so far is kind of hitting harder than the main show in a lot of ways.
Yeah. I mean, I would say that I would agree. I think this season six has been on a whole better than 10C was. Mm-hmm. If you're like judging, season six to, since it kind of sandwiched the two, 10 or 6A and 6B to 10C, I think they were both half seasons have been better. I mean, if you're going to judge season six in part, I think it's better than that last section. Now, mind you, the episodes of season 10, like the first 16 of season 10, some of them are great.
Yeah.
I can't use that same tape measure and say the same for the first 16. There were some great episodes. And, you know, LT, you weren't here with us to talk about those, but.
Well, I was listening. You were listening and commenting.
Yeah, you were. Now, as far as I've talked with a lot of disdain over World Beyond, and I'm going to continue to. I'm hoping it's going to be better, but that show just doesn't interest me at all. And, you know, certainly I'm going to tell listeners that this is certainly better than World Beyond. So to me, I think that this season has been pretty good. Has it been as good as, say, season 3? No. Has it been as good as, say, season 4A, which 4A I thought was really, actually really good. It was 4B that things really started going
falling off the cliff. Yeah.
Yeah. But 4A was good. 3 was good. Parts of 2, especially the second half of 2, I think were good. Parts of 1 were good, except for the 9 days, you know.
Tiny little parts of 1 were good.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Because again, for those that don't recall me saying so, you know, I quit watching Fear very early during the first run.
Yeah.
And it was only through gentle words of encouragement from Mr. Malosh that I started watching again. And I think I picked up it might have been end of 4A, 4B, somewhere in there is when I came back. And I've since watched everything to get caught up. And I'll admit, I was not a Fear fan in the beginning, and the later seasons have kind of won me over a little bit more. Mm-hmm. And I'll agree with you that there have been some weak moments and there have been some strong moments, and you could say as a whole that maybe Fear has not necessarily been as strong as the main show in some ways. Yeah. But I think as time has gone on, they're having more hits than misses. I think they've kind of found their stride. It took them a little while, but.
For me, I think that, and, you know, it's been a long episode, so I want to end it with this point. I think that this is, season 6 is way better than season 5. Mm-hmm. You know, season 5, I mean, I think the only reason why, like, we were seriously thinking about not covering season 6, and I think the main reason why we decided to cover season 6 is that that COVID happened, you know, and we had a dearth of content. So, you know, when season 6 came, we wanted to cover it. So we did. And, I think that, you know, had that not happened, we probably wouldn't have. But, you know, now that we have, I've been happy with it. I mean, I think that it hasn't been perfect. I mean, there have been some episodes that have been not so great. But I think, I don't know, a lot of people have given up on it, and I understand why. And, you know, they're, a lot of the podcasts are just dogging on it. We aren't. And when I hear some of the podcasts dogging on it, I'm like, I don't really see it that way. I don't, you know, it's like, I understand what you're saying, but I kind of respectfully disagree with you.
Yeah.
You know, so, but
well, it's like you and World Beyond.
Yeah.
I'm going to watch it because I'm going to watch it.
It's the same.
I still like fear content or Walking Dead content. And, you know, if somebody has to watch it so that we have something to talk about, then, you know, I'll take a bullet for the team.
It all depends on what is going on when it comes on, you know. If I've got something else to podcast on, I will probably, you know, like go to the side, you know, and cover it like I did last time, but we'll see. Anyway, any final thoughts about this episode?
No, I think we've pretty well said what we need to say.
The only thing that I wanted to add was that Athena calls Morgan Babaji, and I had to look that up. It is an Indian honorific that means father, usually with great respect or said to a priest. So that's what Babaji means. So okay. I guess Morgan was doing that in respect to Grace's heritage. Okay, so let's move on to news, ratings, and info, and we're going to cover ratings for two episodes.
What the hell is happening?
I have no idea.
Okay, so I guess I'll do this in chronological order. So if you recall from the last episode that we did, season 6, episode 10 got a 0.26 in the 18 to 49 with 1.102 million viewers. And since I've been covering them all through the last few episodes, it got a 0.38 in the 25 to 54 and a 0.65 in 50 and over. So going to our first episode that we covered, season 6, episode 11, The Holding. It was even at a 0.26 in the 18 to 49, but lower in the total number of viewers with 1.033 million viewers. And it was up in the 25 to 54 with a 0.40 and down in the 50 and over with a 0.56. Unfortunately, when it comes to this week's episode, I have to say it got a 0.25 in the 18 to 49. Okay, so that's only a 0.001 decrease, so I wouldn't play it for that. But it got 988,000 viewers. So why is this significant? Well, this is the first time in the history of the show that it earned under 1 million viewers. So this is not good. I know that The World Beyond got that before, but this is the first time for Fear to score under a million. So it's like I've said, the ratings for all TV has gone down significantly. It's not just The Walking Dead, but The Walking Dead, unfortunately, The Walking Dead universe has declined significantly. So,
yep.
Anyway, in the 25 to 54, it got a 0.36, down from 0.4, and a 0.55 in the 50 and over, down from 0.56. So, and my big joke of this half season, Talking Dead, the last 2 weeks were that was even from the previous week in both season 6, episode 11 and 12. It did not air, so it was the same. Anyway,
no change,
divide by zero error. However, we can at least say that for the parrots, we had a nice little bump, and we got last week in the Parrot Analytics, The Walking Dead returned to the top 10 at number 10. It got a 36.4 times the demand of an average show. So this is, you know, down quite a bit from before, but supposedly, according to Parrot Analytics, it got to 10th, but was largely because some of the shows that were above it declined faster, like The Flash was one of them, out of the top 10, so it got back into the top 10. But unfortunately, this did not stay, and I guess The Flash came back the previous week. It looks like The Mandalorian came back into the
top 10.
And Clone Wars. So yeah, a whole bunch of Star Wars stuff. Probably because of May the 4th be with you.
And Sesame Street.
And Sesame Street. Well, no, Sesame Street was there before.
Well, that's true. But
yeah,
it showed up and then it's sliding right back off.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, yeah. So I guess Walking Dead is, you know, just under that. But the number 10 show this past week was at 35.9 times, and The Walking Dead was the previous week had 36.4 times. So obviously it was under 35.9. So maybe it was in 11, maybe it was in number 12, who knows? But anyway, it didn't make the top 10. Okay, so that's it for this double shot episode. So let's bring it to you, LT, and tell people how to contact us and leave feedback.
Okay. We want to encourage you to follow us on Twitter. That's at WalkingDeadTTM. Also on Instagram at the same handle. To submit your theories and feedback, most people post in our designated episode thread in our Facebook group, facebook.com/groups/WalkingDeadTTM. You can send us email at walkingdead@talkthroughmedia.com. You can also use our feedback forum, which is at talkthroughmedia.com/feedback. If you'd like to leave voicemail, you can call 216-232-6146. Remember that all of our new episodes are on YouTube. Just search for Talk Through Media and remember to subscribe and click the bell to get notified when we have new videos. Those videos go out first before the podcast does. We want you to like and review the Talk Through Media Facebook page at facebook.com/talkthroughmedia. The best way that you can support us is through our Patreon. That's at www.patreon.com/walkingdeadtalkthrough. We would like to thank our Patreon supporters, Clint McCollum, Renee Murray, and Lawrence Todd.
That guy.
That guy. You can subscribe to us in Apple Podcasts or the podcast client of choice. While you're there, please give us a rating or a review. You can also leave us a review at podchaser.com. There you can rate individual episodes or the whole podcast. Remember to share our posts on Facebook and Twitter when we post them, or tell a friend. Word of mouth is still the best way to get us new listeners.
And, of course, the other podcast that is actively going on right now is Rebinge DS9. We don't always mention that on here, but Kim and James are, I believe, now on season 3 of Deep Space Nine, Star Trek Deep Space Nine. Yeah. And they're going strong. So look them up on the network. They're on the Talk Through Media all-inclusive feed, but you can also find them wherever your podcast client of choice is. Just search for them. And I keep mentioning the Patreon for the other Star Trek Talk Through Media podcasts. We will be doing that hopefully soon. We have finally started talking about when we're going to do it, but we haven't settled on a date. But in that, we're going to talk about some stuff. So anyway,
in things.
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff going on with Star Trek. So new shows coming on and second season of Lower Decks and all that stuff. So,
yep.
And Kyle, I don't know. I don't know if Kyle's going to be ready to come back for that or not, but that comes back in August. Our next episode is season 6, episode 13 of Fear the Walking Dead, titled JD. And I put in brackets, is that referring to John Dory or maybe even June Dory? It's the only JDs I can think of. Written by, we don't know, that hasn't been released yet, but directed by is an interesting person. I know she's a fan of the show, Aisha Tyler. So, didn't know she was a director. We don't know the description of this one, so, you know, maybe June or John Dory is an accurate one, we don't know. But anyway, until next time, I'm Brian.
And I'm LT.
And this is Fear the Walking Dead Talk Through. Good night, everyone.
Good night.